Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Geek Girls, Inequality and Opportunity in Silicon Valley, by France Winddance Twine, narrated by Machelle Williams. Preface. Augusta Ada Byron, also known as the Countess of Lovelace, is recognized as the first conceptual computer programmer, a visionary who anticipated the future of computing more than a century before the first electronic modern programmable computer was built. Ada Byron, the only child from the marriage of Annabel Milbank and the poet George Gordon Byron, was born on December 10, 1815. Her father, who was commonly known as Lord Byron, separated from her mother when she was 4 weeks old. Her mother, an educational reformer, introduced Ada to mathematics as a child. During an era when aristocratic women in England were tutored by governesses and barred from attending universities, Ada was tutored in British mathematics by family friends, including Augustus De Morgan, a founding professor of computer science at London University, now University College London. In 1833, the 17-year-old Ada Byron met Charles Babbage, an English inventor known as the father of the computer. A Cambridge-educated mathematician, Babbage designed the first general-purpose computer and became one of Ada Byron's mentors and collaborators. Babbage, who used his inherited wealth to advance British mathematics, hosted a series of salons where leading British scholars discussed the new ideas in British science. In an article describing the early education of Ada Byron Lovelace, Christopher Hollings, Ursula Martin, and Adrian Rice situate her training in a larger historical context. Lovelace's early mathematical education can be viewed in a broader context of changes in British mathematics. Her later mentors, Babbage, De Morgan, and Somerville, were at the heart of attempts to change it, and to align mathematical education and research with newer, more rigorous approaches emerging from Europe. The widespread availability and use of elementary mathematics also led to a surprising familiarity with mathematics in popular culture. Young ladies did examples from Euclid for pleasure. Periodicals like The Lady's Diary published mathematical questions and readers' answers, and astronomy was a popular pursuit. Ada Byron acquired the title of the Countess of Lovelace from her marriage to William King, who became the first Earl of Lovelace. In an analysis of Lovelace's mathematical abilities, Thomas Misa argues, "The evidence is reasonably clear that Lovelace created the first step-by-step elemental sequence of instruction, that is, an algorithm for computing the series of Bernoulli numbers that was intended for Babbage's analytical engine." In a review and analysis of pioneering women in computing, Denise Gurer explains the significance of Ada Byron's theoretical contributions to modern computer science. Her paper discussed the difference engine, the first automatic calculating device, and the analytical engine, which contained the first set of principles for a general-purpose programmable computing machine. Lovelace's series of notes included a table describing the operations necessary for solving mathematical problems. She therefore became the first conceptual programmer for Babbage's analytical engine. In subsequent writings, she developed the loop and subroutine concepts, a century before electronic computing machines appeared. I begin with the contributions of Ada Byron Lovelace, the daughter of English aristocrats, for two reasons. First, Lovelace was a Victorian mathematician who laid the foundations for modern computing technologies a century before the first electronic computers were built. The analytical engine was a forerunner to the electronic calculating computers built in the 20th century and shares key design features used in modern computing. Second, until recently, women who were pioneers in the field of computing had been written out of the history of artificial intelligence and computing technologies. Ada Byron's accomplishments during an era when women were excluded from attending universities reveal the ways that class status, social capital, and family support intersected to allow her to pursue the study of advanced mathematics in Britain. On the other side of the Atlantic, 90 years after the birth of Ada Byron Lovelace, a Cherokee woman who would co-found the Society for Women Engineers was born. Mary Golda Ross, a citizen of the Cherokee Nation, was born in 1908 and grew up in rural Oklahoma. Ross taught high school mathematics before she became a statistical clerk for the Bureau of Indian Affairs in Washington, D.C. After earning a graduate degree in mathematics, she was hired for a wartime job at Lockheed Missiles and Space Company, now Lockheed Martin, in Southern California in 1942. Ross, the first woman to be classified as an engineer at Lockheed, co-founded the first chapter of the Society for Women Engineers, SWE, in Southern California, and later founded another chapter in Silicon Valley. The Society of Women Engineers is now considered part of an old girls network that has 40,000 members globally. After the war ended, she continued to work for Lockheed and became the only woman in a 40-person think tank for special projects, the Skunk Work, out of which was born the Missile and Space Division. When the firm launched LMSC in Sunnyvale, she moved to the Valley and worked there until her retirement in 1973. In 1999, Ross reflected on her career. "You could just practically name what you wanted to do. It was terribly exciting. They'd give us a mission, and we'd figure out how to accomplish it." Lockheed Missiles and Space Company played a key role in the opportunity structure for women engineers in the mid to late 20th century. In an analysis of industry archives and interviews with former employees, Glenna Matthews notes, "From about 1960 to the very recent past, Lockheed Missiles and Space Company, LMSC, was the largest private employer in Santa Clara County. At the height of the firm's prosperity, it employed some 25,000 employees, of whom 20 to 25% were female, depending on the year." That Lockheed employed a few women in highly responsible positions, and that the firm had a ladder for encouraging those in secretarial or other hourly jobs to move into management, suggests that LMSC may have inadvertently been a catalyst for social change. During the mid-20th century, women were welcomed into the aerospace industry. Silicon Valley military contractors were pressured to hire talent, and although women were concentrated in non-engineering jobs, they could still prove themselves, and, if given an opportunity, could remain in their positions after the Second World War ended. But by the end of the 20th century, the workforce of Lockheed had shrunk dramatically. Esther Williams, a white engineer and co-founder of the Society of Women Engineers, was born in 1913 and grew up in Washington, D.C. She earned a degree in engineering at the University of California at Berkeley. During the Second World War, Williams was hired by the Kaiser Shipyards in Oakland. After the war, she secured a job at Douglas Aircraft of Southern California before going to Lockheed. Williams organized a meeting while she was working in Los Angeles, and Mary Ross was among the 18 women who attended. They were both transferred by Lockheed to Silicon Valley, where they established another chapter of the Society for Women Engineers. Both women benefited from labor unions, which played a key role in the development of corporate policies that allowed women to move up the occupational ladder within the firms producing military-based electronics. In the mid-20th century, defense contractors like Lockheed recruited, hired, and promoted women in the aerospace industry. Women engineers like Ross and Williams created the first infrastructure of support for women engineers. Mary Ross died in 2008 in Los Altos, California, the heart of Silicon Valley. 3 years before Ross's death, Sarah Lamb, an independent British technology consultant, was invited to a geek dinner in London. As one of the few women at this male-dominated event, Lamb's experience inspired her to organize a dinner for Girl Geeks in London. Lamb, now Sarah Blow, recalls, I'd been in the business world for 12 months when I decided to start up the Girl Geek Dinners, and it all came after going to a geek dinner event. The situation there was enough for me to realize how isolated women in the industry were. It also made me understand that some, not all, men don't really know how to react to a technical female. I blogged the idea about a geek dinner for girls, which is how the name Girl Geek Dinners came out of it all. In 2008, Angie Chang founded the Bay Area chapter of Girl Geek Dinners and organized the first Girl Geek Dinner, which was held in San Francisco. 400 participants attended. The mission of Girl Geek Dinners includes the following: to break down old-fashioned stereotypes, to identify roots around barriers to entry for anyone to get into technology, to encourage and nurture women who are interested in technology, to work with local schools, colleges, and universities to encourage more women to enter the tech industries, to support women who are currently in the industry and work together to figure out the problems and the solutions, to include men, women, and children in this journey and not exclude men from Girl Geek Dinner events. These dinners have since developed into a network of 64 chapters all over the world, which provides a support structure for women in technology and inspired the title of this book. Geek Girls provides the first multi-ethnic and multivocal sociological portrait of the optimism, opportunities, and obstacles that cisgender and gender-fluid technically skilled women negotiate in their pathways into careers in technology firms in Silicon Valley. Are you a founder, entrepreneur, venture capitalist, engineer, or someone else who wants to enter the technology industry? Do you care deeply about racial, gender, and economic justice? Are you interested in moving beyond diversity theater and unconscious bias trainings that have failed to change the status quo? If you want to peek behind the Silicon Valley curtain and learn from technically skilled women working in this industry, this book is for you. Introduction. To be a computer geek is to be the ultimate 21st century entrepreneur, someone who reaps the very tangible rewards of the most lucrative scientific field of the new millennium by virtue of being talented, capable, and driven. Roli Varma, 2007. On July 17, 2012, Marissa Mayer, a 37-year-old white Stanford-trained computer scientist and Google executive, was hired by Yahoo to serve as its seventh chief executive officer, CEO. At the time, Mayer was one of the most glamorous, powerful, and highly visible geek girls in Silicon Valley. When Mayer accepted the position as Yahoo's CEO, she was the youngest CEO, male or female, of a Fortune 500 company, a distinction that placed her at number 3 on Fortune's annual 40 under 40 ranking. In an industry dominated by Asian and white men, Mayer stood out as a blonde, blue-eyed geek celebrity considered beautiful, brilliant, and fashion-forward. Her geek girl status and hyper-visibility generated constant media scrutiny. At the age of 24, Mayer was the first woman engineer hired at Google. 13 years later, she was the vice president in charge of managing geographical and local search products, including Google Earth, for one of the world's most powerful technology firms. When Mayer joined Yahoo, she was described as someone who has both business acumen and geek cred at the helm. The New York Times described her as being a member of a short list of women in the technology industry to hold the top spot. At the time, only a handful of white women, including Sheryl Sandberg, chief financial officer, CFO, of Facebook, Meg Whitman, CEO of Hewlett-Packard, and Virginia Rometty, head of IBM, enjoyed comparable leadership positions in Silicon Valley. Mayer's departure from Google was interpreted by some industry insiders as evidence of the phenomenon known as a leaky pipeline, which refers to the loss of qualified women at a company that had been distinctive for having strong women leaders. Reporting for the New York Times, Claire Kane Miller noted, executives have been concerned that too many women drop out in the interviewing process or were not promoted at the same rank as men. So they created algorithms to pinpoint exactly when the company lost women and to figure out how to keep them. Simple steps like making sure prospective hires meet other women during their interviews and extending maternity leaves seem to be producing results, at least among the rank and file. Still, senior women at the company are losing ground. Since Larry Page became chief executive and reorganized Google last year, women have been pushed out of his inner circle and passed over for promotions. They include Marissa Mayer, who left last month to run Yahoo after being sidelined at Google. 7 months before Marissa Mayer was hired to lead Yahoo, the December 2011 cover of San Francisco Magazine featured the headline, "Tech's Femme Boom." Miriam Nafisi, a serial entrepreneur and founder of Minted, a stationery website, was featured on the cover as a geek crasher. This celebratory cover story profiled 24 women who worked in the tech industry as angels, investors, founders, and connectors. In a section titled "The Strong Suits," Marissa Mayer, then age 36, was featured alongside Meg Whitman, Carly Fiorina, Sheryl Sandberg, and Beryl Bartz, former Yahoo CEO. These women had broken what sociologists call the glass ceiling, an invisible barrier that women bump up against as they seek to advance into leadership and management position. In spite of the high visibility of a number of high-profile white women in Silicon Valley, like Marissa Mayer, men continue to rule in Silicon Valley, and the mythology of the geek male genius remains intact. In a study of women in geek culture, Roli Varma reminds us of the significant role that gendered mythologies play in beliefs about who can be a talented engineer. Drawing on the work of Roland Barthes, Varma notes, "Myths circulate in daily life, and once they become established in people's beliefs and values, myths serve the ideological agendas of the dominant classes. Gendered constructions of technology portray women's normal occupations to be in non-computing areas, while men's dominant employment to be in high computing areas. Geek culture legitimizes men's exclusive claim to computing on the one hand and diffuses the power relations between men and women in the high technology sphere on the other hand." In an article titled, "Where is the Female Mark Zuckerberg?" in San Francisco Magazine, E.B. Boyd begins with this declaration. "For the first time in history, girl wonders actually have an edge over the boys. Can the new femme entrepreneurs seize their moment?" Later in the article, Boyd argues, "Four decades into the tech revolution, people are still chafing at the fact that there are so few women in the industry, that the typical startup involves a handful of brash young guys and the occasional geekette. The excuses haven't changed much either. Women are risk-aversive. Women aren't technical. Women can't figure out the work-family balance. Venture capitalists are so besotted with male Harvard and Stanford dropouts that they barely give brilliant female entrepreneurs the time of day. And yet, in the new boom reshaping Silicon Valley, the old paradigms, gender and otherwise, are rapidly shifting. Now there are more female founders than ever before, but for the first time in tech history, women founders in certain types of businesses have an edge over their male peers." 3 years after this optimistic and celebratory special issue was published, a steady stream of blogs, memoirs, lawsuits, annual diversity reports, and investigative reports by technology journalists began to lift the curtain on the diversity problem, sexual harassment, systemic wage discrimination in Silicon Valley, gender inequality, and anti-Black racism. The rejection of domestic minorities, especially Blacks, Latinx, and Native Americans, remains entrenched in publicly traded technology firms in Silicon Valley, including both American and Indian multinationals with offices in Silicon Valley. While white women have made modest gains moving into management, This has not been the case for Asian American women, Black women, or Latina women. Annual diversity reports, foundation reports, and investigative reporting have all found that the exclusion of Black and Latinx women across all categories of tech employment remains durable. The leadership ranks and decision makers at the top technology firms remain dominated by Asian and white men. Hidden figures, data analytics, and inequality. On October 11, 2013, Tracy Chow, a 26-year-old Chinese-American engineer at Pinterest, who had formerly worked at Google and Facebook, wrote a blog post on Medium titled, "Where Are the Numbers?" arguing, "Every company has some way of hiding or muddling the data on women actually in engineering roles. The actual numbers I've seen and experienced in the industry are far lower than anybody is willing to admit. I can't imagine trying to solve a problem where the real metrics, the ones we're setting our goals against, are obfuscated." 3 years after Chow's post, 250 companies had submitted data to Chow's repository. In 2016, women who worked in San Francisco and who had at least 10 years' worth of experience responded to a survey titled "Elephant in the Valley," about their experiences as women in the technology industry. This survey generated a massive set of data and was released on a website. This survey found that of those surveyed, 60% reported unwanted sexual advances, while 1 in 3 women reported feeling unsafe at work. Suddenly, the media narratives about Silicon Valley shifted from its being a region of opportunities to a brotopia, a toxic work culture where women endured sexual harassment, systemic pay discrimination, and racism. Articles and discussions on public media about the diversity problem became a regular theme. On May 28, 2014, Laszlo Bock, a Romanian-born businessman who was the senior vice president of people operations at Google, appeared on the PBS NewsHour to participate in a discussion on the diversity problem in Silicon Valley. In response to the revelation that only 6% of Google's employees were Black, 2%, or Latinx, 4%, whereas more than 91% were white or Asian, Bock blamed the educational pipeline. "Part of it is women aren't taking a lot of computer science courses, and the culture of the tech industry at a lot of places isn't that great for women. We have been working on this a lot at Google, and particularly in the last year, working on bringing more unconscious bias training to our employees and more awareness of this. For African Americans and Hispanics, the conditions are even worse. It is a smaller population. Even fewer percentage of people with, from those ethnicities actually earn degrees in computer science." In this same interview, Gwen Ifill poses the question, "We have known that the numbers weren't good, even though we didn't have actual numbers to put to it. Why wasn't action taken before?" Vivek Wada, an entrepreneur and professor of engineering at Carnegie Mellon, responds to Ifill, "Frankly, Silicon Valley is a boys' club. It's like a frat club run wild, is what I often say, because you have young kids hiring other young kids. They don't understand the importance of diversity. They don't understand why they have to be inclusive. Most people are not overtly sexist, racist, or homophobic, but we're human beings. And as a result, we like people who are like us, who watch the same shows, who like the same food, who have the same backgrounds. So we bring this unconscious bias to everything we do. More broadly, though, you have an educational system problem. There is an absolute pipeline problem." In 2016, only 17.9% of university degrees in computer science were awarded to women. Scholars have identified a gender gap in employment in science and technology fields. During the past 3 decades, employment in STEM fields has grown by 338%. The high technology sector employs 25% of professionals in the United States. Jobs in computing have experienced the largest job growth of any sector in the U.S. economy. This job cluster of computing jobs, including software engineers, software developers, mechanical engineers, and programmers, is one of the highest paid and most prestigious fields, yet women, especially Blacks, Latinx, Native Americans, and Pacific Islanders, are being hired at much lower rates than are Asians and whites in the technology sector. In 2019, the Los Angeles Times surveyed tech workers of diverse backgrounds and found that of the 68 tech workers who responded to the survey, half said they felt tech was not inclusive to people from diverse backgrounds. People whose identities are underrepresented in their field find themselves judged through a different set of lenses, one that ignores questions of privilege. Scope of this study. Geek Girls is an innovative, integrative, and intersectional analysis of inequality and opportunity in Silicon Valley's technology industry, the most economically vibrant sector of the U.S. economy. Silicon Valley is the power center of the new economy in the United States. This book provides an analysis of the experiences of technically skilled women who design software, develop new apps, build hardware, write code, and write technical guides. It examines the multiple pathways that women technologists follow into Silicon Valley careers. Technically skilled women working in Silicon Valley are neither a singular nor homogeneous group with regard to their ranked status and positions in a racialized and class-stratified industry. Yet our scholarly understandings of the occupational experiences of women in the technology industry have been informed primarily by the experiences of middle and upper middle class immigrant Indians, Asian Americans, and white women who have earned degrees in engineering and are presumed to be cisgender and heterosexual. Geek Girls departs from much of the earlier work that provides intersectional analysis of the U.S.-based high-tech industry in several ways. Geek Girls draws on interviews with cisgender and transgender women of diverse ethnic, racial, and class origins. This is also the first intersectional analysis of women in Silicon Valley to include the caste background of the immigrant Indian women who participated in this study. Thus, this study engages and builds on a rich body of data on the South Asian diaspora and the ways that caste-based hiring and merit operate in the global technology market. Geek Girls sits at the intersection of feminist studies, critical technology studies, and comparative racial and ethnic studies to provide an analysis of the social, economic, caste, and ethnic dimensions of opportunity structures in Silicon Valley's technology industry. This book makes significant contributions to earlier studies that examined discrimination in technology markets and moves beyond these by engaging with critical race scholars. Race scholars working in the interdisciplinary field of technology studies have introduced a new set of conceptual tools, including digital elites, digital feminism, digital caste system, and digital discrimination. Research on the IT caste and labor migration has failed to provide analysis of the relationship between Asian Indian immigrants and highly educated and technically skilled Black or Latinx employed in Silicon Valley. I make three central arguments in this book. First, I argue that the quantity and quality of social and symbolic capital that women possess inform and shape the obstacles and opportunities available to them as they launch their careers and seek jobs in Silicon Valley. I introduce the concept of geek capital, a form of social and symbolic capital that emerged in my analysis of the occupational narratives of women and men in this study. I found that Asian American, Asian Indian, and white women's social proximity to men embedded in the technology industry, with whom they share a caste, class, racial, ethnic, and/or familial relationship, provides these women with privileged access to decision makers who can offer them entry-level and mid-level jobs. Geek capital is not simply about technical skills. It refers to networks, social relationships that include membership in exclusive alumni, ethnic, status, or class-based networks that ties one to members of a transnational technocracy. In this study, 40% of the white women and 90% of the Asian Indian women possessed forms of geek capital as the daughters, siblings, spouses, cousins, domestic partners, former classmates, or friends of men and women embedded in the technology ecosystem. These women were typically from high-caste, middle-class backgrounds and were second-generation engineers. This type of social capital is called bonding capital and connects members of the same exclusive social networks. These networks can include alumni networks, transnational caste-based networks, regional networks, and family networks. Geek capital allows job candidates to be perceived as possessing merit-based qualifications. Their abilities and skills are recognized and rewarded by members of the tech ruling class, who attended a small number of U.S. schools and Indian institutes of technology, and comprise a narrow slice of the university-educated racial and ethnic demographics in the United States. In a study of hiring practices between the 1950s and the early 1970s, Janet Abate found that the most popular strategies for recruiting programmers produced contradictory constructions of skill. My second argument is that an occupational caste system operates in Silicon Valley that consists of layers of discrimination concealed by beliefs in meritocratic recruitment practices. The social discrimination against Blacks, Latinx, Native Americans, and Dalits, members of India's lowest caste, in hiring, recruitment, promotion, and retention is normative and has profound economic consequences for members of these outgroups. The national media covering the technology labor force has reported widely on labor discrimination lawsuits and investigative reports that have documented systemic employment discrimination against Blacks, Latinx, women, and non-Asian domestic minorities, alongside a strong preference for white and Asian men. I argue that this discrimination is a product, in part, of corporate recruitment practices and exclusion from the social networks of members of the dominant ethnic groups in the tech industry. My third argument is that a persistent belief in and defense of the pipeline myth and the myth of meritocracy has shielded Silicon Valley technology firms and their executives from being held accountable for their role in reproducing structural racism and gender inequality. I identify and analyze the social and cultural mechanisms that reinforce racial, ethnic, and caste inequality among technically skilled women. The use of social referrals and recruitment practices has reproduced structural inequality and left the ethnic, racial, and gender hierarchies in Silicon Valley's workforce intact. CEOs and their representatives continue to place responsibility on the educational pipeline for the dismal numbers of Black, Latinx, Native American, and other underrepresented groups in Silicon Valley. Research methods. Geek Girls draws on a total of 87 interviews and surveys conducted between 2015 and 2019 with men and women employed in Silicon Valley. The interviews included 65 women and 22 men. In addition to interviews, this study draws on blogs, memoirs, surveys, industry-based surveys, Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, EEOC reports, foundation reports, technology journalism, annual diversity reports released by technology firms, and U.S. Department of Labor investigations. Several research methods were employed to recruit participants, including 1. Facebook postings on a page for women hackers, 2. A key informant at a technology firm, headquartered in downtown San Francisco, who provided an initial set of referrals, 3. Targeted snowball sampling, 4. Tech inclusion conferences and lesbian in tech conferences held in San Francisco in 2015 and 2016, 5. An underground vegan restaurant in Oakland, 6. Organizing events for contract workers in Silicon Valley, and 7. Referrals from colleagues and neighbors. The interviews ranged from 60 minutes to 120 minutes, and they were recorded and transcribed. Participants and, in some cases, company names have been changed to ensure confidentiality. I employed focused coding to identify recurring themes. Participants. Geek Girls draws on interviews and survey data from four generational cohorts of women technologists between the ages of 20 and 58 and employed in Silicon Valley. The participants entered the technology industry between 1989 and 2016 and belong to cohorts representing four generations, including baby boomers, born between 1946 and 1964, Generation X, born between 1965 and 1980, Generation Y, millennials, born between 1981 and 1994, and Generation Z, born after 1995. Among the 87 participant-completed surveys, 63% were with Generation Y, millennials, 33% were Generation X, 2% were baby boomers, and 2% were Generation Z. The technology workers who participated in this study include natives of the United States, foreign nationals, and naturalized citizens from Brazil, Britain, China, India, Germany, Japan, and Mexico. The technology workers who participated in this study self-identified across a wide spectrum of sexual expressions and gender identity. Among the 67 women in this study, 65 completed the biographical surveys. The survey data show that 68% identified as cisgender and heterosexual, and 31% identified as LGBTQ. White and/or European American women made up 38% of the engineers in this study, Asian Indians 23%, Blacks 16%, Asian Americans 13%, Latinx 6%, and multiracial and other comprised 8%. The remaining participants were cisgender men. The participants were employed or formerly worked at startups, privately owned companies, and publicly traded companies including Adobe, Airbnb, Amazon, Apple, Autodesk, Cisco, Dropbox, Eventbrite, Facebook, Google, IBM, Indiegogo, Intel, LinkedIn, Lyft, Oracle, Patreon, Salesforce, Square, SurveyMonkey, Twitter, Uber, and Yahoo, as well as more than 20 startups. 3/4 of the participants in this study were engineers, software, security, front-end, back-end, or full-stack. The technology workers who participated in this study included entrepreneurs, engineers, founders, graphic designers, technical trainers, technical writers, diversity consultants, digital marketers, and project managers. The 65 women in this study worked as engineers, designers, consultants, digital marketers, project managers, technical writers, and customer support advocates. Slightly more than 1/3, N equals 27, of the participants identified as LGBTQ, and close to 2/3, N equals 38, identified as cisgender, straight, or heterosexual. Among the women engineers, 1/5 of the white engineers had earned a certificate in a 12-week accelerated coding boot camp after earning their undergraduate degrees in the arts, humanities, social sciences, or area studies. Earlier studies of women in science and technology fields have typically employed analyses that flatten the experiences of women and have not included gender-fluid women or those who identify as LGBTQ in their analysis. One goal of this book is to provide a nuanced analysis that illuminates the differences between women and the mechanisms that sustain ethnic, racial, and gender inequality in Silicon Valley firms. This book contributes a region-specific case study to a growing number of recent sociological studies of women in the technology industry. However, these earlier studies have not provided fine-grained accounts of the complex ways that gender identity and sexual expression operate in concert with race, caste, class background, and marital status to produce barriers to employment in the technology sector for highly educated Blacks, Latinx, and other underrepresented groups. The women in this study followed 6 pathways into the technology industry. 1. Recruiters. 2. Referrals by friends, family, classmates, colleagues. 3, coding boot camps. 4, internships. 5, international visas. And 6, digital online job boards. The two most common pathways involved social referrals and recruiters. These pathways were followed by women with a wide range of educational credentials and technical expertise. Women who used recruiters often possessed forms of symbolic capital. Simply by having a prestigious degree and being embedded in powerful alumni networks associated with one of the feeder schools into Silicon Valley, including, but not limited to, Carnegie Mellon, Harvard, MIT, Stanford, UC Berkeley, UCLA, University of Washington, University of Texas at Austin, and the prestigious Indian Institutes of Technology, IIT. A third pathway was followed by women who earned degrees in the arts, humanities, or social sciences, and who had no technical experiences, but enrolled in all-women accelerated skills-based engineering academies, also known as coding boot camps. A fourth pathway involved women who were self-taught or who developed technical skills outside of formal classrooms and launched their own businesses before being hired by Silicon Valley firms. A fifth pathway involved women who immigrated from India or Latin America to pursue graduate study in the United States and entered the industry after earning graduate degrees in the United States and working on temporary migrant contracts before going into a full-time contract. The research site, Silicon Valley. Silicon Valley is a region in Northern California that is the epicenter of the North American technology industry. The city and county of San Francisco form the northern boundary of Silicon Valley, which extends south for 35 miles along the San Francisco Peninsula. The geographical boundaries south of San Francisco include all of Santa Clara County and San Mateo County and the cities of Fremont, Newark, and Union City in Alameda County. Silicon Valley is the global epicenter of the technology industry and the home to more than 2,000 startups and technology firms, including Alphabet, parent of Google, Apple, Autodesk, Cisco, Eventbrite, Facebook, Oracle, Salesforce, Twitter, Uber, and Zendesk. It is the economic engine of the largest state by population in the United States and a vehicle for upward mobility, financial stability, and economic growth. It is also an industry that has generated vast wealth and opportunities in a region of stark inequalities, where local residents who are Black, Latinx, or Native American remain virtually invisible in executive boardrooms and in technical positions in the technology sector of the economy. According to the 2010 U.S. Census, Silicon Valley's ethnic composition is 35% Asian, 33% white, 25% Hispanic or Latinx, 2% Black, and 5% other or multi-ethnic. Foreign-born residents make up 39.1% of the population, with China 18%, Mexico 16%, and India 13%, accounting for 47% of the foreign-born, followed by Vietnam 10%, the Philippines 10%, Europe 8%, and other countries in Asia 12%. Among the residents, 25% have earned a graduate or professional degree, 28% have a bachelor's degree, 22% have some college, 14% are high school graduates, and 11% have some high school. On January 10, 1971, Don Huffler, a technology journalist, used the term Silicon Valley in a three-part series of articles on the men, money, and litigation behind the semiconductor business. Writing for the Electronic News, a now obscure industry trade journal, Huffler was the first to popularize that term. When Huffler used that term, most local papers referred to this region as the Santa Clara Valley electronics industry. Today, the term is used to refer geographically to this area south of San Francisco, metonymically, to refer to the entire technology industry based in Northern California. Silicon Valley takes its name from the main component in semiconductors. Before the production of silicon chips, software, cloud computing, and information technologies replaced plums, prunes, apricots, and other agricultural products as one of the dominant industries. This region was called the Valley of the Heart's Delight. Timothy Sturgeon argues that the Silicon Valley technology industry is nearly 100 years old and grew out of a historically and geographically specific context that cannot be recreated, and that its roots can be traced to the early electronics industry that emerged in San Francisco Bay in its early days of experimentation and innovation. Between 1909 and 1960, a series of technological inventions and commercial products in wireless communication technologies and military electronics used by the aerospace industry and the U.S. Navy, consumer electronics, microwave ovens, and commercial radios were developed in the larger San Francisco Bay Area. These innovations, networks, and military financing laid the foundation for many new industries, including radio, telegraph, telephone, film, hi-fi stereo sound systems, public broadcast, and radar systems for the military. Radio waves and telephone and telegraph communications with military applications were the new technologies of the late 19th and early 20th century. A decade after Hewlett-Packard was founded, the transistor was invented at Bell Laboratories in New York by William Shockley. A Stanford graduate and native of Palo Alto, Shockley returned to his home region and set up the Shockley Transistor Corporation after leaving AT&T's Bell Laboratories. In October 1957, 8 engineers who had been hired by Shockley established the Fairchild Semiconductor Company in Palo Alto with financing from the Fairchild Camera Shop in New York. Historians of Silicon Valley have described Fairchild as the single most important firm because of the number of companies that it spun off. Between 1959 and 1961, research teams at Fairchild and Texas Instruments independently developed the integrated circuit. Another decade would pass before Intel was founded in 1968. Intel was a small firm that invented the microprocessor, called a computer on a chip, a breakthrough invention that followed the microchip. This invention laid the foundation for a new generation of personal computers that followed. A region of stark inequalities. On June 23, 2020, the San Jose State University Human Rights Institute held a press conference outside the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Library in downtown San Jose. It released a report authored by Scott Myers Lipton titled The Silicon Valley Pain Index, the first of planned annual reports on racial discrimination and income inequality in Silicon Valley. Myers Lipton, an activist and sociologist at San Jose State, drew on 65 different data points to analyze racial and income inequality in the Silicon Valley. Myers Lipton concluded that white supremacy is operating in most of the institutions and systems in Silicon Valley. In Silicon Valley, residents who earn less than $82,000 per year, or $117,000 for a family of four, are considered low income. The city's minimum wage is $15.59 per hour, which means a minimum wage earner working 40 hours per week with no vacations will gross $32,427.20 per year, far less than the median rent for a one-bedroom apartment. Many homeless, unhoused residents in the San Francisco Bay Area who sleep in homeless shelters are employed full-time during the day. Since 1970, real income in the United States, that is, income adjusted for inflation, has been nearly flat, but the cost of major purchases, houses, cars, education, has increased ahead of inflation. Scholarship on the experiences of working-class immigrant workers in Silicon Valley's electronics industry have examined the unequal labor conditions of low-wage workers in the technology industry. Scholars have argued that Silicon Valley technology firms have reinforced local and global inequalities. Focusing on low-wage immigrant Asian and Latino women, David Pello and Lisa Park identified stark inequalities in exposure to chemical toxins, access to health care, and the precarious job situation they endured. Power, privilege, and wealth are relational, which often means that one person's riches and leisure time are derived from another's impoverishment and hard labor. One socioeconomic or racial or ethnic group's access to safe, high-salary jobs and clean neighborhoods is frequently linked to another group's relegation to dangerous, low-wage occupations and environmentally contaminated communities. The South Asian diaspora in Silicon Valley. Silicon Valley is home to the largest diasporic Indian population in the United States. Indians are the second fastest growing immigrant group in the United States after Mexicans. The four states that have the largest numbers of Indians include California, 21%, New York, New Jersey, and Texas. Asian Indians are 1.42% of the California's state population and are concentrated in the highest-paying and most lucrative job in the technology industry. Workers on the H-1B visas comprise about one-sixth of the total IT workforce in the United States. Between 1990 and 2000, the number of Indian workers on H-1B temporary work visas grew by about 113%. During this same decade, an estimated 900,000 skilled workers entered the United States on H-1B visas. According to the Institute of International Education report, students born in India were the second largest group of international students in U.S. universities enrolled in STEM majors after China. Three immigration acts have played a role in transforming the ethnic structure of Silicon Valley's labor workforce. The H-1B non-immigrant visa program for temporary workers was created by the Immigration and Nationality Act of 1952. This act allowed United States employers to hire foreign workers on a temporary basis, with an annual cap of 65,000. The act was amended by the Immigration Act of 1990, which allows employers to hire skilled foreign workers for specialty occupations on a temporary basis. Payal Banerjee describes the changes introduced by the 1990 Act. A specialty occupation is defined as one that requires theoretical and practical application of a body of highly specialized body of knowledge and a bachelor's degree or its equivalent. The H-1B visa, classified under the non-immigrant category, is considered a temporary work visa that can last for up to 6 years. Changes enacted in 1990 made it possible for immigrant workers on the H-1B visa to have the dual intent of working on a temporary basis and adjusting their status to permanent residency. Scholars studying the labor migration and occupational experiences of IT workers have provided a rich body of literature on what scholars call the IT caste, which refers to workers described as urban, highly educated, high caste, and middle class Indians who are employed in the global IT labor force in Australia, India, Europe, and North America. This research has provided important insights into the challenges, negotiations, and successes of Indian transnational IT workers who have migrated on student visas or temporary employment visas. Scholars have argued that Asian Indian migrant workers are racialized when employed on temporary work visas and before they secure permanent residency in the United States. In a study of temporary workers employed on H-1B visas, Renee Reichel-Luthra argues, many H-1Bs later transfer to permanent residency status, so the disadvantages posed by the visa are seen as a temporary trade-off for longer-term entrance into a labor market with high rewards for H-1B skills. Once they transfer to a permanent residency status, their high skill levels should enable them to compete in H-1B occupations. Sociologists have produced a wealth of literature on employment discrimination and specifically on the way that status or group membership structures the hiring process. Most of the India-born women in this study had family members who immigrated to the United States in the 1980s. They described a highly organized and well-positioned transnational network of support that helped immigrant Indians get settled and secure jobs and sponsorship in the United States. Today, there are Facebook groups and other online communities that provide a roadmap to jobs, permanent residency, and eventually naturalized citizenship in the United States. Shiva, a 30-something India-born woman who immigrated to the United States to pursue a graduate degree and moved with her husband, an engineer, to the Bay Area, described the Indian version of the American dream. She recalls a how-to manual that her uncle consulted. It provided detailed information on the steps to follow in his migration pathway to the United States. My uncle came here in 1981 or so. At his school, the use of these manuals is very well known. I think this manual still exists. They used to have this thing called ROTGAD. It's an acronym, Realization of the Great American Dream. Basically, in this manual, it provides details for when you apply for an immigration visa, when you go to the interviews, what kind of answers, what kinds of questions can be expected, what kinds of answers do you give, what regarding the different schools, what are they good at, your multiple entry visa, all this kind of thing, navigating the U.S. border. It's a minutely calibrated system. They've figured out the system, and they play the system well. That all translates to when you come to the U.S. with so much social support. Indians constitute the largest group of immigrant engineers in Silicon Valley. As a result, immigrant Indians possess an important form of capital called bonding capital. Bonding capital is a form of social capital that operates within groups and creates network closure. This form of social capital is distinct from bridging capital, which is capital that provides resources that are not available within one's group. It is an inclusive form of social capital based on weak ties between groups. Compared to U.S. domestic minorities, who remain underrepresented in technically skilled positions, Black, Latinx, or Native Americans, immigrant Indians and their U.S.-born children possess higher quantities of bonding capital. They hold a disproportionate number of the technically skilled jobs, and recent lawsuits have alleged discrimination against non-Asians and a preference to hire Asian immigrants for technical positions. Theoretical concepts. Beginning in the 1970s, sociologists studying gender inequality in organizations generated a cluster of new concepts that illuminated how structural inequality operates in the workplace. These include tokenism, labor queues, and inequality regimes. Joan Acker introduced the concept of inequality regimes to describe the loosely interrelated practices, processes, actions, and meanings that result and maintain class, gender, and racial inequalities in all organizations. In other words, even organizations that have explicit egalitarian goals tend to develop inequality regimes over time. These regimes do not exist in a vacuum, Acker says, but are built from inequality in the surrounding society, its politics, its history, and its culture. In Men and Women of the Corporation, a foundational sociological study of women in a New York corporation, published in 1977, Rosabeth Moss Cantor provides a trenchant analysis of the mechanisms that reproduce gender inequality in a corporation. Cantor introduces a number of new concepts, but her most significant is a theory of tokens. Cantor argues that the life of women in the corporation was influenced by the proportion in which they found themselves. Defining a token, Cantor writes, those women who were few in numbers among male peers and often had only woman status became tokens, symbols of how women can do, stand-ins for all women. Sometimes they had the advantages of those who are different and thus were highly visible in a system where success is tied to becoming known. As a pioneer in the study of gender in organizations, Cantor's analysis preceded the emergence of intersectionality in studies of employment discrimination in the field of sociology. Today, gender organization theory has developed, and there are studies that employ a more intersectional analysis that considers LGBTQ women and Black women negotiating multiple axes of difference. Geek Girls introduces several concepts, including geek capital, glass walls, and first and second generation technology workers. These concepts build on earlier sociological literature on employment discrimination, gender inequality, and racial inequality in the U.S. labor market. This book is in conversation with an interdisciplinary body of research on gender, labor, technology, and employment discrimination. Geek Girl engages with debates in several research streams, including 1. Gender inequality in organizations, 2. Women in computing and engineering, 3. Labor market discrimination, and 4. Caste, class, gender, and migration. Geek capital. Geek capital is a form of social capital that does not require one to have technical experience or even a degree in engineering or computer science. This form of capital is produced, in part, by a matrix of advantages, including class or caste privileges, that facilitate movement into the technology sector. What is significant about geek capital is that it illuminates the way symbolic capital, whiteness, family occupations, is intertwined with ethnic, caste, and class background to enable gatekeepers to interpret the applicant as an ideal worker in cultural terms, in addition to any specific technical skills that they may have. An example of how geek capital operates can be seen in the experience of Giselle, the sister of a Silicon Valley technology executive. Giselle, sister of a tech titan, drifts into the industry. Giselle's career trajectory represents one pattern found among the white women in this study, who began their careers in non-technical careers, such as high school teachers, administrative assistants, or marketing, and drifted into the industry through their familial relationships with a white male family member who was employed in the technology industry. Family members and friends provide social referrals to jobs, which represents a significant form of geek capital.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.